Just 2 years after the fall of the Soviet Union in 1991, the Congress of the People's Deputies of the Russian Federation and the Supreme Soviet declared then-President Boris Yeltsin a traitor. The country was undergoing massive political and economic stress. Senior Fellow for Europe and Eurasia at the American Foreign Policy Council, Wayne Mary, said that it was the economic stress which tipped the scales on October 4, 1993.
In the middle of the holiday season, which brought into question the legitimacy, literally, of the banknotes in people's pockets.
Yeltsin and his opponents saw the future in radically different terms. Yeltsin and his circle were launching into capitalism through the privatization of Russia, while his opponents sought to protect the social safety net and work out methods of modernizing Russia's economy along social democratic lines. Consequently, Vice President Alexander Rutskoy and his colleagues in the Supreme Soviet attempted to block many of President Yeltsin's reform efforts. Yeltsin, though, circumvented their efforts by proroguing the legislature and ordering the writing of a new constitution. This led to the Supreme Soviet declaring Yeltsin a traitor and attempting to replace him with Vice President Rutskoy. Things only got more heated from there, and the political brawl eventually was taken to the streets. Mary described the scene from his window at the U.S. Embassy.
Barricades, cars in flames, all sorts of wreckage from urban battle, and of course with the tower of the Russian White House in flames.
Mary said that Yeltsin was not anticipating the strong reaction from the thousands of opponents.
I think the Yeltsin team were entirely unprepared for the effectiveness with which the opposition was able to rally. Not only rally physically, bringing thousands of people to the Russian White House, but also the extent to which they attracted to that side of the barricades significant numbers of people who were active Russian reformers, including people like the chairman of the Constitutional Court, Valery Zorkin, whom I knew fairly well, who thought of himself as being the Russian John Marshall, people like Oleg Rumyantsev, a constitutional reformer, who thought of himself as being the Russian James Madison, and a number of other people who were not so much opposed to the nature of the economic reforms the Yeltsin team were trying to force through, but whose principal focus was on constitutional legitimacy.
Mary said that the Clinton administration at the time overlooked the problems with Yeltsin and instead saw him as a force that would prevent communism.
There was a tendency not to regard problems of constitutional legitimacy as serious and to believe that Yeltsin's ability to impose macroeconomic stabilization policies on the country under his 12-month emergency powers were in some way open-ended and indefinite, which most certainly they were not.
The events of 20 years ago represent a Russian story, but Mary also believes that other nation actors like the United States played a role, whether through their ideology or their inaction or their silence.
By 1993, Russia was a highly pluralistic political environment, but largely non-ideological. And it was the United States which had at the core of its Russia policy essentially an ideological perspective. The Washington Consensus, which was entirely about state-sponsored economic reform with very little notion of consent of the governed or let alone of popular participation. This became the basis of everything that happened in ensuing years. The oligarchs, loans for shares, you name it. And I do think that while these issues were obviously decided by Russians, as I said at the outset, I think there is unmistakably a degree of American complicity in what happened in those years, and hence some degree of American accountability for everything that happened in the ensuing years.
He notes that the United States may be in denial about many recent international events. He mentions U.S. misperceptions of Egypt as a case in point, but others may come to mind. Ellie Mui, VOR News, Washington.